It's like they're made of silly putty.
That shit is just real. I mean, that's what makes this music sound the way it is and move.
It's the syncopations and the spaces of the syncopations.
I'm speechless.
Well, he listened to a lot of Bruno Mars. Musicians
React. Hello and welcome back to Professional Musicians React.
Today we're gonna listen to James Brown. We're gonna dive into two of my favorite James Brown songs. This is Cold Sweat, and then we're gonna listen to one of my favorite performances of all time, his performance on David Letterman. Here we go.
Yep.
I don't care. Woo. About your past. I just want a love to last.
Jumbo or Clyde?
I don't care.
I think
that's it.
Cause it's Swan?
I think
about
this is Clyde.
Oh, it's Clyde.
Wow.
Thick. I just want
the full track is 7 minutes, so we're not going to listen to the whole thing here.
Oh, my God.
But let's just talk about that first bit, because that is such a groove. And maybe we'll listen to the Maceo solo as a little bonus toward the end. There's so much to talk about in just those, really what equates to two bars of material.
Right?
It's two bars of original material with incredible execution.
Yeah. Okay, we have an icebreaker question. What song can you not stop listening to right now?
Oh, I got one.
That's JJ Johnson. He's a drummer. He's played with John Mayer, Gary Clark Jr., and Lenny Kravitz.
Fleetwood Mac, Prove Your Love. You've got to prove
your love to me. Jack, what were you gonna say?
Mac Miller is the artist. Mac Miller's the artist. The song is called Good News.
I got what my song. Got? I owe it to you.
That's Sean Hurley. He's a bassist who's played with John Mayer, Alicia Keys, Rob Thomas, and a jillion other people.
Yebba, My Mind, performance. My mind,
my mind. Dijon? Have you guys heard of this guy, Dijon? It's a song called Big Mike's. What makes James Brown funk? Like, what is this feel? What, it's such an iconic brand of funk. Why?
To me,
why
it's, does it sound it's like the that? Syncopations and the spaces of the syncopations from the bass perspective. And then the commitment to, like, you know your part, right? So I'll see you at minute 7, and that's still your part. It has not changed.
Part police.
Yeah. Right.
It's part police, and he was part police.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No deviation. That's the
your
part.
Got you. Got you.
Yes.
That's 5.
Yes.
But even in the way that they feel time, what's going on there? Like, what?
Because
how's
no
this different
one has
than a
to
grid?
Do all the lifting. So over the two bars, it's like, okay, when you start going, okay, the guitar parts, and then it stops, and then it peppers in. It's all these accumulation of spices. So the bass goes boom. And then it fills it.
Can you play the bass part for us?
Sure.
And JJ, can you play with Sean?
Yeah.
I'll take the horn part. Ryan, you do the guitar part too.
Okay. I don't know if I remember it. I just remember the
just
one.
Just play
note.
C. To me, it feels like you're going up And then that second measure is just a ooh.
Yeah.
So the first measure takes a little bit longer.
Right.
And then the second measure is just a downhill.
Yeah, it's the placement of the low bass note, where the low bass note comes in the measure, which is, I think, it's not where I would think the low note would be. Can we count it in?
I think it's on the and of one.
Yeah. One, two, three, four, one.
Uh-huh.
That's such an interesting part for it to drop the octave.
It's the and a one, so you're in measure two and a one, and then you're like, ooh.
But the time does kind of feel like you described, where it's like, oh.
Because there's so much more space on the front of the part.
Yeah.
And it's interplayed with... and then it just wraps it right up.
Okay, I just want to try this because it would ruin the song. Play that low bass note on the one instead of the and of one.
Okay.
One, two, three, four. It's like it just takes all the funk out of it.
Deflated. Wait,
you know, there's another thing that's really interesting. There's a hole in the middle of the phrase, right? Bump. There's that space where nobody's playing.
Yeah.
And it's right here, listen.
Yeah.
Right there. I just want three and. One, two, three, and.
Silence, breaks, muting, ghost notes, all these things help control the character of a phrase.
That's Molly Miller. She's a professor and has a doctorate in musical arts. She's a guitar player. She's played with Jason Mraz, Black Eyed Peas, and the house band on Listen to Your Heart on ABC.
For example, when I talk like this, it is very boring, it is totally sterile, and is not interesting. But when I add things like really dramatic pauses, breaks, suspension, it adds a lot of vibe and character and emotion to what's happening.
Yeah, if you look at funky shit, there's oftentimes just a complete space in the middle of it.
Yes.
You gotta have some space, otherwise.
Gotta have some space. It's like a good relationship. <You know? laughs> Not that I'd know.
Can we hear the guitar part with the just guitar and bass? Because that interaction is so hot. So.
The guitar part there is different than later on. Later on, it's pretty much just on one.
But I hear it going something like that.
Yeah.
Is that really guitar?
I hear it.
I don't care about your past.
Yeah, okay, and let's hear that with the drums.
Getting there.
And then, okay.
Give us a couple hours. Yeah. We'll lock in.
Right? They probably just shedded that until it was just locked magic. And then they start the tape, and that's the tune, you know?
Right, because some of the James Brown tunes, he's guiding them through, I'm going to take it to the bridge.
Yeah.
It'll count. It's like, once you get it simmering, like, okay, now we're ready.
Exactly. Exactly. And he is such an instrumental part of the groove. His voice is drums, right?
When he's
hitting those, ha! Like he's hitting those moments right where there'd be a snare crack or something, you know?
Yeah,
it's pure emotion when his voice comes in. It's also really loud there, but just the sound of it.
So okay, good. let's talk about the second original bar, which is that that chorus section or that B section, whatever you want to call it, doesn't really feel like a chorus to me. It feels like a B section.
Right.
What's so interesting here is the guitar part interacting with the horns, right? That's what makes this part special to me.
When you kiss me, when you mess me,
it's gotta be two guitar players.
Yes, there's totally two guitar players, one doing the strum and then one doing the picking.
Right.
Tim, do we know if there are two guitar players on this?
Yes, there are.
And are they, they're both playing live, right? There's no overdubs on this?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Jimmy Nolan and Alfonso Kellum.
And what's crazy is the bass still does the same kind of thing and drops a big E-bomb on the four chord, which is an F.
Woo!
And it doesn't matter. He goes.
He drops an E-bomb on the F.
And he's playing the. Somebody's, there's some 1-4 action in the bass. Listen again.
When you get me.
Yeah.
When you mess me. Hold my hand.
Oh my gosh. That's so funny.
It's gut-wrenching. Only can work in tonally, a la James Jamerson with all the chromaticism, the stew, the tone, the tape, the overdriven saturated tubes.
Yeah.
We're cooking.
You know, the other interesting piece of that too is this recording compared to, say, what we listened to earlier, more modern recordings, the volume of the bass, the presence of bass frequencies
right.
is so much lower because they were printing on vinyl and you didn't want to overload the vinyl. And there are all these constraints around the actual medium and into which they were recording and how it was played back. But the bass frequencies are, I don't want to say inaudible. You can hear bass, but compared to modern mixes, the bass is way lower. And so you can get away with rub like that because it's not overpowering the mix. It's more buried.
The other thing is the internal logic of both parts is airtight.
Right.
So if you just play the bass line.
Right.
That makes so much sense. Like it feels right. And then this part.
It doesn't even feel wrong.
No.
Yeah, so to just make clear, what Sean is pointing out is the rub between this chord and that's the bass note. That's what's happening. But because it's an octave below and because both parts on their own make so much sense, that just feels so good. And what Sean is playing feels so good that it doesn't matter. In fact, the fact that it doesn't quite fit together might be what makes it so interesting and engaging.
Absolutely.
We could do our experiment where you change the note.
It's like Hans Greunering James Brown.
Hans Greunering.
Let's fix all these notes and see what... We'll put this on a grid. We'll change that to an F. Should we try it?
Actually, I think let's try it.
Okay.
Let's change it to an F.
Dangerous to mess with the past.
It's dangerous to mess with, totally. It's like listening to it the wrong way. It's like when they CGI better explosions for the Death Star. It's like, show me the original shitty explosion.
Grainy,
I don't want to see CGI Jabba the Hutt. I want to see
CGI James Brown.
Yeah.
Can we speak to Clyde real quick? What makes Clyde?
There is a undeniable touch and feel that he has. Yeah, and it's really light, too. Definitely not muscular. It's his touch on things, but it's like there's this relationship between hi-hat and snare drum that speak with each other. And, you know, and by design, I mean, this was, keeping in mind, like, this was James's concept.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what sets him apart from everybody else and kind of making an imprint in music history. It's just the way that he heard things. there's so much percussion. Like, the whole band is essentially a percussion troupe.
Right? Yes.
Right.
Yes. And, everybody's playing drums on their instrument.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you know, I know it's been made common knowledge through other avenues, but that shit is just real. I mean, that's what makes this music sound the way it is and move. But, you know, with that sort of guidance, I mean, came obviously his natural ability to hear and translate that into what we listen to. I think anybody should spend the time to understand that. I don't care what kind of music you play. It's just like just understanding music and also just parts and sections.
Yes.
And being...
They're all listening so hard.
And you said before, like, this works because of everyone's contribution to
it. The way
it
fits together.
Yeah.
I think what's hard about this music is this is true ensemble playing. This is a group playing as a group.
Yes.
Not as individuals playing their instruments.
Yeah.
And I've found at least the tendency, you know, with pockets of chords and everything else, it's not hard to play things. It's hard not to play things.
Like, absolutely.
The hard part about producing a session is getting everybody to play less, I feel like. Getting everybody to just play, like, to get a group to do enough. This, to invent this, is very difficult to get people to only play that much.
Yeah.
That's the hardest part.
But there's a feeling that I get sometimes with pockets that what this sounds like to me is you can tell when everyone's listening to you. When everyone's listening to everyone and you can hear people reacting to little nuances in what you're doing, like, it just makes everyone feel heard. It's like such a basic thing, but you can hear it in the result. Like, these are people not only listening to everyone else, but everyone feels like they're being heard and they're responding to each other. I had one other thought listening to this, which is, so when I was playing with Ben Folds, he is the drummer. He's playing piano, but he is laying it down and everyone is following him. Wherever he's putting the time, he's speeding up and slowing down and, like, you better hang on for dear life. In a lot of bands, the drummer is the drummer. Like, the drummer's laying it down and everyone's playing on top of them. To me, Clyde feels like he's in the middle of the groove. Like, he doesn't feel like he's laying it down and everyone's playing on top of him. Everyone feels like they're in it. They're all tangled up in the groove together.
Like a section.
Yeah.
Integrated.
Yeah.
That's a really good point.
That's the only way I think that it really works, but it takes a special drummer to be able to percolate there and not be the leader, but not be the follower.
Yeah.
It's very, very different sense than something like Gravity, where that hi-hat is the metronome. And gravity. He's not the yardstick that everyone is measuring themselves against. He's part of the ensemble in the playing. And that's a different sound and a different feeling. It's also mixed like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's mixed, like, in with the rest of the soup.
The guitar parts, the bass parts, yeah.
It's all one thing. It sounds like one thing, actually.
Yeah, and I think James is laying it down. And you can't see him in the recording.
But you can visualize it.
Yeah, you can visualize it, and you hear the result. Like, everyone's watching him. And you hear every, you know what I mean? It's like, it's almost like looking at the groove through a mirror.
Mm. Oh, that's a really good point.
Try,
I want to see if we, because when we played the groove before, I'm sorry to take us back to a previous thing, but when we played the groove, we didn't achieve that pause.
Oh, you say.
How dare you?
I want to see if we can lock into that pause, because it's such an iconic part of this song. Let's listen to where that pause is and figure out what it is and see if we can achieve that and get there. Here it is.
I don't care about
right here.
Your past.
Can we try and get there?
Yeah.
Felt better. Should we listen to James Brown live on David Letterman?
This is one of my favorite recordings of all time.
Just the sonics of it?
I mean, just the amount of energy coming off of the stage.
I couldn't believe, like, James Brown took over the studio. And yeah. It was like, he's running the night as if he's producing a song in the moment. It was like, okay, I want to take it to the bridge. Like, he's telling everyone, you'll see it, but it's like, no, when I say get up, I mean get up. Yeah. So he stops and tells everyone to get up. But I was like, they couldn't have let this go, right? And they did let it go. I mean, he comes back again. You got to watch all of it because yeah. it's a long
There's
evening.
There's like two songs and then the interview. Right. And then James says like, actually, can I do one more song?
Yeah,
I want
exactly.
to do one more song.
It's Letterman's so like, raw. I love it. But it was like, this was network television.
Right.
There were commercials.
But it was 1:30 in the morning.
Right. Right.
And this is before, like, the internet and TV. Like, if you were watching it, that's
great.
Who
if
saw
not,
it.
You had no way. How are you ever going to see this again?
You know, that's a quality, though, that I think exists in a lot of truly great artists, is a complete disregard for how things should be done. And here's what sure. I want to do, and here's my vision, and so I'm going to do it this yeah. way. Let's
should
listen to the performance.
It?
Here we go. This
I've
is,
heard. I've heard.
This is James Brown live on Letterman 1982.
This is on television.
Get up and party. We want to see a party. Yeah. Is that all right, fellas? Turn it off. Yeah. 1, 2, 3.
Fuck.
Yeah.
Get up.
God.
Stay on the scene.
Get up. Look at Hiram, dude.
I know he's
Look
loving it.
Look at how he's moving. You could plug your ears and it's funky.
That's a vibe.
That is a vibe.
That is a vibe.
That energy that everybody's playing, I mean, that he initiates, and then it's contagious. And you just hear all that energy.
Those guys playing with him were like, oh my God, heaven yeah. on earth, because they were.
This was like the moment of the highlight of their careers. And
absolutely.
they knew that it was happening at the time. They were just so excited to play with him.
I'm speechless. I think it's easy to think about James as a musician and as a singer and as, you know, all that. But I think another thing, and I know he gets credit for this, but it becomes very clear watching this recording, is his leadership.
Oh, yeah.
Well, absolutely.
Just
yeah.
his ability, like, stopping the record because the audience didn't stand up and be like, no, that's not what we mean here when we say stand up.
When we say get up, what do we mean?
Get up.
Get up.
Get up.
Get up and party. Get up and party. Get up and party.
He's showing you the way to the party, and then he's showing you how to party, and then partying, and then everybody can't help but follow this guy and be a partier. He's such an incredible, inspiring leader on yeah. top of the musicality and everything else. It's just incredible leadership, watching him get that party going and watching him get everybody standing up. So special.
On live television.
Yeah.
Which is, as we all know, it can be the stuffiest of gigs.
Yeah.
Be like,
and the awkwardest of gigs.
Right, right. It just doesn't feel, it's like we have 5 minutes to wow you and do a 90-minute, you know, it's like there's no warm-up, there's no middle, there's no ending. It's like.
But this was also like, TV is so different now. It's almost hard to imagine. Like, nobody was awake. This is like the kids. They like gave the TV station to the kids
right.
at night, and we're like, guys, everyone's asleep. Do what you want.
Yeah.
So it's just like,
because this is on at the end of the show, basically.
Yeah. Can you imagine turning on your TV and seeing that? How did you guys hear about this? When was the first time you guys saw this performance?
It's some time ago, but I do remember I was an avid viewer of the Letterman show, and I'm obviously, because Dave is, you know, a genius and
yeah.
Hilarious, but being a young musician then was like, you know, so I was like, you wait for those few seconds and you can just hear the band playing
right
in the outro and the intro coming yeah. in with each break. Mm-hmm. Like, and sometimes they would play a little bit longer and they would be playing, it was almost like they were telegraphing stuff because they would, you know, they would play a lot of instrumental versions of many different things. It was like, oh, it was just the coldest thing. Like whenever you would, but really it was like, I'd stay up late to be able to just hear that rhythm section play.
Were you watching during this era?
Yeah, definitely.
So you knew who Steve Jordan was?
Yeah, absolutely.
What about you? Were you?
I was younger and was not allowed to stay up that late, so I'd hear about it.
I wasn't either.
I had to first work up to SNL because I'd hear all about that. But I saw this probably from David Ryan Harris, who was like, oh man, he knew about everything that had already happened that I missed out on.
Yeah.
And so he's like, oh, you got to check this out.
Yeah.
You see Steve. It's even more fun when you know somebody's like, oh, Steve, when he was, you know, mid-20s and they're on Letterman, I got to check that out. And like, you got to see the way James Brown is having the time of his life with these guys. So I would hear about it, read about it in magazines because Will Lee would always be, you know, come up at least a year, once a year, there'd be an article in a magazine, and it's like, oh, he'd listen to the song on his way up to the elevator. You know, Cher would be the guest tonight. He'd be learning the song on headphones, and then they'd play it live, and it's like, wow, this is an amazing club that these guys get to be part of. And then I just, all that footage, I'm so glad it's available now, because it's amazing what happened on late night TV.
The moment at the end of that performance, the way that James Brown looks at the band, he's elated.
There's a thing that James does in almost all his records, or I don't know if it's almost all, it's a lot of the records, where he asks the band if he can do something.
Yeah.
And then the band responds affirmatively. Yes, James, you can. But it's, yeah, let's do it. And James like, can I do it? Yeah, let's go, let's do it. And the way the band sounds when they do that, which happens at the beginning.
When we say get up, what do we mean?
Get up and party.
Well, he listened to a lot of Bruno Mars. Bruno Mars and Anderson .Paak.
I find myself wondering, just like as a producer and, you know, in the studio, I find myself wondering, like, was there a moment where James like, guys, when I ask you a question, I want you to shout yes at me. Like, how did it, or did it just happen? Like, you know what I mean? Like, how did
was that it calculated?
Tradition, was it calculated? Did he have a vision for, like, I want the band to be my tribe that's, like, shouting and saying yes, and we're going to do it together?
I would guess, I was not around in the days, but I would imagine it's a bit of preacher congregation.
Yes.
So while we know, hey, this is when we do this, and this is when we do this, it's like,
that's such a good point.
The role is, it's exciting. It's like putting on a play. So, hey, we know what's going to happen. Right. But it's so exciting, like, tell me to stand up. I'm ready. Or it happens in concerts all the time.
Totally.
You know we're going to, okay, that breakdown. I want you to sing this third chorus with me.
Yes.
All right. Yeah.
He's just a master of tension.
Yeah.
When he says, you want to go to the bridge? And they say, yeah. Should we go to the bridge? Yeah. You all know what's coming, but it's not happening yet. And you're just like.
And I don't know if it's going to be two or four or three.
We don't know how long.
That's what me, even to this day, with tension, like, I don't know. Is it an even or an odd number of times?
I was watching him to see if I could figure out how the band
would know
when, because he doesn't give you four. He gives you three or seven.
He gives you about a half a beat. I mean, like, that second time they go to the bridge, he asks six times through the progression. And literally at like the end of four, of right before beat one of the bridge, he turns around.
What's the cue? Is the cue a nod?
The cue is hands, body movement. Like,
right,
but
right.
That's also, everybody has to be absolutely engaged.
Yeah.
At every.
And they were.
Yeah, certainly. But even like the same thing on records too. It's like the way you have to be engaged and be prepared for, because he's kind of conducting on the spot as well. And a lot that, and that's a beauty in some of those things that become like this playful thing, but it's like, no, that's, when he's saying, it's like, sometimes you kind of, and you go back and listen to it, it's like, oh no, he's, like, that wasn't on any kind of chart, but it's like, it's the take.
It's real.
And in the middle of this take, like, last time we did the take we did before, like, this section was this length of time, like, well, this time it's this. Just stay with me. Be engaged and be ready to move.
It keeps people on their toes.
It really does. It's like modern television when you don't know which character is going to drop at the next episode and who they're going to kill. You have to watch just to see what's going to happen. And the same thing is true in this recording of James. You have to watch him to see when you're going to go to the bridge.
It's dangerous.
Yeah.
But you see, I mean, even the way we're speaking of it, it's like this level of, like,
it's excitement.
It's thrilling.
Yeah.
What I'm looking for.
It's excitement. It's tension. Like, when they go to the forecourt, the forecourt in itself has so much tension.
Yeah.
But it's also the release of the tension as well.
That's when it's like, whoo.
Yes.
Yeah.
When that organ comes in and it's huge and the horns are swirling up there. And then he does, and then, okay, we got to talk about his dancing, because how can you watch this video and not talk about his liquid legs, which look
liquid
like they are
legs,
not
patented.
Made of.
Yeah, yes. I know.
Copyright that.
I mean,
liquid legs. Oh.
It's like they're made of silly putty. It's unbelievable to watch.
Sean can move like that.
Let's see it.
But I need the right, it's the fabric of the pants.
Yeah, he needs
they give
the
you
right
the sway.
That's true.
Without
that's
those, true. We're...
What are those, Levi's?
Yeah, the,
you can't
too
do it.
Stiff,
no,
too hard.
Those 501s, you can't do it in those.
Yeah.
The way he uses his instrument too, his voice, he's just like, that squeal.
Yeah, he's harmonically, like, he's got all of that.
Got built-in distortion.
Yeah.
Where that comes from, I mean, physically impossible.
I know, right? Very few people on
Earth
can
do that. It feels like
it
comes from trying to do it and failing for like 10 years, and then that sound just came out.
Yeah, it is really interesting. It's such a good point. There are overtones on top of that squeal.
What's crazy about hearing one note is you're actually hearing a lot of other notes at the same time. There's this one main pitch that you'll be hearing, but simultaneously, there's these things called overtones that are being heard. They're lower in volume and higher in pitch. They're literally called overtones because they're above the main tone. So for example, when you hear this low E note, you're actually hearing a lot of other notes.
Which is so bizarre that he can hit those strange notes that
there's
are two octaves.
Some Mariah Carey shit that he's,
It's like a reed instrument.
He's got.
When you hear this rhythm section versus JB's traditional rhythm section, are there tells? Are there differences? I mean, they happen to be incredible players, right? It's Steve. But are there things about this band and this recording that you would signal to you, oh, that's not JB's band? Or when you hear it, is it just, that's a great band?
The first thing that sticks out to me is the is Hiram's guitar tone, which at that time it was like a thing that a lot of guitar players were doing, like with those types of effects. When there's like a chorus.
Chorus sounds like it.
Chorus, and he had a humbucker where his bridge pickup should have been.
Like a lot of guys like that, and like Mike Stern and some of those, that was kind of a thing coming out of particularly that school. And that.
Yeah.
That's the first thing, like that's sort of like, but it doesn't ruin it, you know, for me, because of the intensity and the tension that everybody's playing with, and mostly that level of intensity and skill. And same goes for Steve as well. It's like, you know, that's a very youthful energy he's playing, also with somebody with a very solid understanding of funk and how to be funky. I think James was loving that kind of energy that they were giving him.
Right.
That was very apparent.
So they don't sound as beat down as his band does.
Well, the live versus a studio recording from the 60s, live in 1982, there's gonna be so many tells just with the Sonics. First thing stood out to me is the guitar tone.
Yeah.
If these guys, if you assembled them today, they wouldn't sound like that. It's a special moment in time.
And we haven't even talked about the fact that James put on this performance. At this point, he'd been making music for 30 years.
Right.
Yeah.
Imagine you're 30 years in and you do this.
Hardest working man in showbiz, they say. But it's inspiring as a player and as a person, like the love and the joy that is just oozing out of all these guys, the young and the old. They're like, and even Letterman's like, he could have stopped hosting the shows, like just giving it over to James. Like everyone was like, yes, this is what it means to be alive and to have purpose, if only for the love and joy of creating music and enjoying music, the audience there, like, how can you not be moved by that performance?
Yes. Yeah.
And taking the opportunity to do that, because it's not like James showed up for the show and it's like, this is what I'm going to do when I go on David Letterman.
Right.
You know, I seriously doubt that was happening. It was just sort of like, in the spirit of things, energy is like, let's do this. And people, you know, obviously respected him enough and it's like, yeah, let it happen.
Can we watch the hits at the end? Like, those last four or five are not in time, are they?
No, but...
They're just watching him.
We could do that. If we go, if this is how we want to end it, we can commit to that.
You got to rehearse it.
But, right?
Would they have rehearsed?
But.
Would they have rehearsed this?
I think, well, they did. There was a sound check.
Right, and the horns even, it's like they have an MD. James has an MD.
Okay. So.
Somebody took leadership. Is like, this is how I've seen him end it. I mean, we've all done it. Not that Paul would have been able to look on YouTube. It's like, oh, I've studied his last three shows, and this is how he likes to end the song. But somebody would have given a tip like, hey, this is how we end it live. Ba 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 ba. He's got the long ending. He's got the short ending. There's got to be There's got to be an agreement.
He kind of invented like looping for big bands. You know what I mean? Because there was like all the ingredients floating around and the rock and roll and the blues and the rhythm and blues and the big bands. And he kind of put it all together and said, okay, just play this bar.
It was house music before electronics.
Right.
Yeah, in some ways. Loops and samples and
We have a question from the YouTube community. Should we dive in? Shout out to our viewers on YouTube. This is from Leonardo Ribeiro de Lima. What would you guys say is James Brown's hardest characteristic to mimic? And why has no one been able to do this since?
Well, there's a certain tone that he has that he owns and a raspiness and the way he delivers a vocal. I mean, it's funny to watch people try to, because he's so enigmatic, you know, and it's like, it's almost otherworldly. And it's funny to watch people, you know, like, oh, you know what they're referencing.
Right.
It's kind of like, but nobody ever nails that.
Bruno kind of does his impersonation.
Yeah, a little bit. But I mean, like, in terms of like that sound that he produces is, no one touches that.
Totally.
It's just, which is beautiful about it. And it's like, cannot be reproduced. But also, I mean, the influence that he's had over just entertainers because of like not only his knowledge, but I mean, that's the dancing and the moves and the mannerisms. Some of those things can be mimicked, which we do see. And
it's tough because there was before James Brown, then there's James Brown, and then everything after. It's like, if you even touch it, it's like, yeah, but James Brown did
right.
a gazillion times better. It's same with Hendrix, same with people. It's like, if you're an icon.
Yes.
If you, unless you're doing a full-on imitation, you're going to struggle. And then if you do a full-on imitation, you're really going to struggle because we already had the best at it. Right.
That's such a good reference because I feel like people take, in the same way that people take Jimi Hendrix's existence for granted, like it's impossible to imagine a world before Jimi Hendrix. James Brown is the same way.
Yeah.
He just blew... Everyone that came after, you couldn't help but be influenced by him.
I would say the hardest thing to replicate, obviously the vocals, the voice, and his, you know, his vocal energy and performances. But if there was one other thing I'd pick, I'd say it's his ability to craft an ensemble performance, I think is what made him so special. His ability to wield an amazing team of musicians and to get it to sound like that.
Yeah.
Very, very few people, I think, in the world and in history have been able to
control that.
Have been able to wield and control and get that performance from those types of musicians.
He was essentially like, he's a producer.
Oh yeah.
He's the arranger. He's a composer. He's a band leader. He's a singer. He's a front man. You know what I mean? He's kind of doing 30 people's jobs in a way that had never been done before.
And with that, we'll say thank you for watching another episode of Professional Musicians React. Don't forget to subscribe. We come out with new episodes every week. You can leave a comment if you think there's something that we should react to next. And we will see you next time on Professional Musicians React.
See you next week.